Novas.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر جل جلاله كبيرا أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك أشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله على محمد وآل محمد وأجمع أشهد أن محمد رسول الله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا ولي الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين عليا حجة الله حيا على الصلاة حيا على الصلاة حيا على الفلاح حيا على الفلاح حيا على خير الأمل حيا على خير الأمل الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله بر محمد وآل محمد صلوات
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن عليا ولي الله أشهد أن عليا حجة الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير العمل حي على خير العمل قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أرأيت الذي يكذب بالدين فذلك الذي يدع اليتيم ولا يحض على طعام المسكين فويل للمصلين الذين هم عن صلاتهم ساهون الذين هم يراءون ويمنعون الماءون الله أكبر سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر بحول الله وقوته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد كذلك الله ربي الله أكبر اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب الله أكبر
سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
سمع الله لمن حمد الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر الحمد لله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بحول الله وقوته الله أكبر
سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد
الله أكبر أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم
الله أكبر الحمد لله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد تسمية فاطمة الزهراء سلامها
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا من أرجوه لكل خير وآمن سخطه عند كل شر، يا من يعطي الكثير بالقليل، يا من يعطي من سأله، يا من يعطي من لم يسأله ومن لم يعرفه تحننا منه ورحمة. أعطني بمسألتي إياك جميع خير الدنيا وجميع خير الآخرة، واصرف عني بمسألتي إياك جميع شر الدنيا وشر الآخرة، فإنه غير منكوس ما أعطيت، وزدني من فضلك يا كريم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، يا ذا النعماء والجود، يا ذا المن والطول، حرم شيبتي على النار.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله، أشهد أن عليا ولي الله، أشهد أن عليا حجة الله. هيا على الصلاة، هيا على الصلاة، هيا على الفلاح، هيا على الفلاح، هيا على خير العمل، هيا على خير العمل. قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر، إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. الله أكبر. سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي، صلى على محمد وآل محمد. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي، صلى على محمد وآل محمد. الله أكبر. أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر. سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي، صلى على محمد وآل محمد. الله أكبر. بحول الله وقوته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد، الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. كذلك الله ربي. الله أكبر. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. الله أكبر. سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي، صل على محمد وآل محمد. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي، صل على محمد وآل محمد.
الله أكبر. أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بحول الله وقوته. الله أكبر. سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد.
الله أكبر. أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
الله أكبر. بحول الله وقوته. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي العظيم وبحمد ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد.
سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
الله أكبر. أستغفر الله ربي وأتوب إليه. الله أكبر.
سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده. ربي صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم. يا لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين.
الله أكبر. الحمد لله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
محمد وآل محمد. سلوات صل على. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بحق محمد وآل محمد. اپرام آجے بھائیو بہنو بچاو بیمار ہوئے خاص کرینے بہتر مومن بھائی کینسر نا مریض چھے اپرے دعا کرے کہ اللہ اللہ کا بدائی نے شفا دے بدائی نے تکلیفو دور تھائے اپنا عالم و مرجع مومنین مومنات دنیا میں جہاں بھی ہوئے یا اللہ تو لکل حفظ و امان ما راک، ہماری بدی حاجتوں پوری کر، ہمارا علم وداڑو کر، ایوی دعا ساتھ اپنے بدا ساتھ پانچ فیرے ام یجیب پڑھیے۔ اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، امن یجیب المضطر اذا دعاه ویکشف السوء، 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 امن یجیب المضطر اذا دعاه ویکشف السوء۔ سورة فاتحة شفاء المرض ودفن البلاء۔
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد۔ بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم۔ استغفر اللہ الذی لا الہ الا هو الحی القیوم الرحمن الرحیم ذو الجلال والاکرام واتوب الیہ۔ بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم۔ یا من ارجوه لکل خیر وامنا سخطه عند کل شر، یا من یعطی الکثیر بالقلیل، یا من یعطی من سعله، یا من یعطی من لم یسعله ومن لم یعرفه تحننا منه ورحما، عاتنی بمسألتی ایاک جمیع خیر الدنیا وجمیع خیر الآخرہ، واصرف عني بمسألتي إياك جميع شر الدنيا وشر الآخرة، فإنه غير منكوس ما أعطيت، وزدني من فضلك يا كريم يا ذا الجلال والإكرام يا ذا النعماء والجود يا ذا المن والطول حرم شيبتي على النار۔
بالهولي قران
صل على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وسارعوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة عرضها السماوات والأرض أعدت للمتقين. الذين ينفقون في السراء والضراء والكاظمين الغيظ والعافين عن الناس والله يحب المحسنين. والذين إذا فعلوا فاحشة أو ظلموا أنفسهم ذكروا الله فاستغفروا لذنوبهم ومن يغفر الذنوب إلا الله ولم يصروا على ما فعلوا وهم يعلمون. أولئك جزاؤهم مغفرة من ربهم وجنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ونعم أجر العاملين. قد خلت من قبلكم سنن فسيروا في الأرض فانظروا كيف كان عاقبة المكذبين. هذا بيان للناس وهدى وموعظة للمتقين. ولا تهنوا ولا تحزنوا وأنتم الأعلون إن كنتم مؤمنين. إن يمسسكم قرح فقد مس القوم قرح مثله وتلك الأيام نداولها بين الناس وليعلم الله الذين آمنوا ويتخذ منكم شهداء والله لا يحب الظالمين. صدق الله العلي العظيم. سورة المباركة الفاتحة.
أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم الرحمن الرحيم ذو الجلال والإكرام وأتوب إليك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. عن جابر بن عبد الله الأنصاري عن فاطمة الزهراء عليها السلام بنت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال: سمعت فاطمة أنها قالت: دخل علي أبي رسول الله في بعض الأيام فقال: السلام عليك يا فاطمة. وقلت: وعليك السلام. قال: إني أجد في بدني ضعفا. فقلت له: أعيذك بالله يا أبتاه من الضعف. فقال: يا فاطمة، ائتيني بالكساء اليماني فغطيني به. فأتيته بالكساء اليماني فغطيته به، وصرت أنظر إليه وإذا وجهه يتلألؤ كأنه البدر في ليلة تمامه وكماله. فما كانت إلا ساعة وإذا بولدي الحسن عليه السلام قد أقبل وقال: السلام عليك يا أمة. فقلت: وعليك السلام يا قرة عيني وثمرة فؤادي. فقال: يا أمة، إني أشم عندك رائحة طيبة كأنها رائحة جدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله. فقلت: نعم، إن جدك تحت الكساء. فأقبل الحسن عليه السلام نحو الكساء وقال: السلام عليك يا جداه يا رسول الله، أتأذن لي أن أدخل معك تحت الكساء؟ فقال: وعليك السلام يا ولدي ويا صاحب حوضي، قد أذنت لك. فدخل معه تحت الكساء، فما كانت إلا ساعة وإذا بولدي الحسين عليه السلام قد أقبل وقال: السلام عليك يا أمة. فقلت: وعليك السلام يا ولدي ويا قرة عيني وثمرة فؤادي. فقال لي: يا أمة، إني أشم عندك رائحة طيبة كأنها رائحة جدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله. فقلت: نعم، إن جدك وأخاك تحت الكساء. فدنا الحسين عليه السلام نحو الكساء وقال: السلام عليك يا جدا، السلام عليك يا من اختاره الله، أتأذن لي أن أكون معكما تحت الكساء؟ فقال: وعليك السلام يا ولدي ويا شافع أمتي، قد أذنت لك. فدخل معهما تحت الكساء. فأقبل عند ذلك أبو الحسن علي بن أبي طالب وقال: السلام عليك يا بنت رسول الله. فقلت: وعليك السلام يا أبا الحسن ويا أمير المؤمنين. فقال: يا فاطمة، إني أشم عندك رائحة طيبة كأنها رائحة أخي وابن عمي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله. فقلت: نعم، ها هو مع ولديك تحت الكساء. فأقبل علي عليه السلام نحو الكساء وقال: السلام عليك يا رسول الله، أتأذن لي أن أكون معكم تحت الكساء؟ قال له: وعليك السلام يا أخي ويا وصي وخليفتي وصاحب لوائي، قد أذنت لك. فدخل علي تحت الكساء. ثم أتيت نحو الكساء وقلت السلام عليك يا أبتاه يا رسول الله، أتأذن لي أن أكون معكم تحت الكساء؟ قال وعليك السلام يا بنتي ويا بذعتي، قد أذنت لك فدخلت تحت الكساء. فلما اكتملنا جميعا تحت الكساء أخذ أبي رسول الله بطرفي الكساء وأومأ بيده اليمنى إلى السماء وقال اللهم إن هؤلاء أهل بيتي وخاصتي وحامتي، لحمهم لحمي ودمهم دمي، يؤلمني ما يؤلمهم ويحزنني ما يحزنهم، أنا حرب لمن حاربهم وسلم لمن سالمهم وعدو لمن عاداهم ومحب لمن أحبهم، إنهم مني وأنا منهم، فاجعل صلواتك وبركاتك ورحمتك وغفرانك ورضوانك علي وعليهم، وأذهب عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. قال الله عز وجل يا ملائكتي ويا سكان سماواتي، إني ما خلقت سماء مبنية ولا أرضا مدحية ولا قمرا منيرا ولا شمسا مضيئة ولا فلكا يدور ولا بحرا يجري ولا فلكا يسري إلا في محبة هؤلاء الخمسة الذين هم تحت الكساء. فقال الأمين جبرائيل يا ربي ومن تحت الكساء؟ فقال عز وجل هم أهل بيت النبوة ومعدن الرسالة، هم فاطمة وأبوها وبعلها وبنوها. فقال جبرائيل يا ربي أتأذن لي أن أحبط إلى الأرض لأكون معهم سادسا؟ فقال الله نعم قد أذنت لك. فحبط الأمين جبرائيل وقال السلام عليك يا رسول الله، العلي الأعلى يقرئك السلام ويخصك بالتحية والإكرام ويقول لك وعزتي وجلالي، إني ما خلقت سماء مبنية ولا أرضا مدحية ولا قمرا منيرا ولا شمسا مضيئة ولا فلكا يدور ولا بحرا يجري ولا فلكا يسري إلا لأجلكم ومحبتكم، وقد أذن لي أن أدخل معكم، فهل تأذن لي يا رسول الله؟ فقال رسول الله وعليك السلام يا أمين وحي الله، إنه نعم قد أذنت لك. فدخل جبرائيل معنا تحت الكساء فقال لأبي إن الله قد أوحى إليكم يقول إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم رجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. فقال علي عليه السلام لأبي يا رسول الله أخبرني ما لجلوسنا هذا تحت الكساء من الفضل عند الله؟ فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله والذي بعثني بالحق نبيا واصطفاني بالرسالة نجيا، ما ذكر خبرنا هذا في محفل من محافل أهل الأرض وفيه جمع من شيعتنا ومحبينا إلا ونزلت عليهم الرحمة وحفت بهم الملائكة واستغفرت لهم إلى أن يتفرقوا. فقال علي عليه السلام إذا والله فزنا وفاز شيعتنا ورب الكعبة. فقال أبي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله: يا علي، والذي بعثني بالحق نبيا واصطفاني بالرسالة نجيا، ما ذكر خبرنا هذا في محفل من محافل أهل الأرض، وفيه جمع من شيعتنا ومحبينا، وفيهم محموم إلا وفرج الله همه، ولا مغموم إلا وكشف الله غمه، ولا طالب حاجة إلا وقضى الله حاجته. فقال علي عليه السلام: إذا والله فزنا وسعدنا، وكذلك شيعتنا فازوا وسعدوا في الدنيا والآخرة ورب الكعبة. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة.
So, brothers, before I ask the Sheikh to come for the lecture, may I ask you to please move forward with the salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allah. Sorry.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ذرية من حملنا مع نوح إنه كان عبدا شكورا. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. My respected elders, brothers, sisters, salamun alaykum جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. It's undoubtedly an auspicious occasion when we gather together as a community and we remember the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted each and every one of us with the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Many of us have been born into this, not only religion, but this sect as well, or this madras of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam as well. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes reminds us of the grace that He's given us, of having been born in this sect, sometimes because we open our eyes to the difficulty that others have been through in order to arrive at that which we were given and fed on a silver platter. Sometimes we don't pay heed to the gift that Allah gives us until sometimes it's removed from us. It might be that our children might face some difficulty in their theology, in their deen, and that's when we open our eyes. It might be that whilst we were in high school and university, we didn't truly appreciate why God had placed all these restrictions around us. But it's only once we had our own families and we looked back and we met those same people that we were with during university days and high school days, and we've seen where their desires have led them to, and we understand then why God placed those restrictions upon us. When people can't maintain a family bond because of the fact that they've had different types of relationships, we realize why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has restricted us to that which is considered a halal relationship. sometimes it requires other people to open up our eyes. I want to make an incident, to make mention of an incident before we go ahead. I've mentioned this to you many years ago, so it might be a repetition, but if you don't mind, there was a time when I met a brother who had come back to Islam. He mentioned one thing that I think we should take heed of firstly. We always refer to people who have converted as revert individuals. We normally introduce them in our community to friends that this is a brother who's a revert or a sister who's a revert. He did mention, he said, when does this title leave me? He said, whenever you meet me, whenever you introduce me to somebody else, I'm always going to be a revert Muslim. In your eyes, that's all you introduce me as. When will I just be a Muslim like you? When will you introduce me as just your Muslim brother and not your revert Muslim brother? So there was a Muslim brother who was not born a Muslim, but then found Islam in a most peculiar fashion. It's always interesting to see, because you see the difficulties that people go through, and you appreciate what God has given to you and I. He says that he was an alcoholic, a womanizer. He said, I was committing every type of immoral act. At that time, there was no morality and immorality. It was what I made it to be. You stuck within the law of the land, but that too wasn't necessarily moral or immoral. But you made your own morality when you didn't have a religion. He said, once I was in such a bad state, somebody came to me and they just told me that, have you ever thought what would happen if you were on your deathbed? Let's say you went into a terrible accident, you're in hospital, and your wife is sitting by your side, and then this other person that you've had a relationship with, she too comes in, both of them see each other, they're probably both going to leave you. You'll have nobody with you. Because of this immoral act that you keep doing and the alcohol that you're consuming, he said, that made me think that surely there's a purpose. I cannot have been created as such a complex creature to simply fall into a routine of waking up and going to work and coming back and enjoying myself however I wish. And that too, I wasn't considering what I was doing to other people as well. I was just worried about my benefit and my pleasure, not what it was doing to my family or my children or my spouse. So he said, I began to research religions because the natural result of looking towards morality would be to go towards religion. So he said, I studied this religion and that religion, and every religion I went to, I studied. He said, but I couldn't quite find the religion that I was comfortable with. He said, then I looked upon Islam, I researched, I accepted Islam, and then I didn't know, is it this sect or is it that sect? And I was a bit complex, it was too confusing for me. He said, one day one of my friends who had been calling me continuously, he too was an alcoholic, I tried to distance myself from him because I thought if I start going back into his company, he might pull me and I might fall back into that sin. So he said, I stay away from him. I never picked up his phone call. So once there was a knock at the door, it was him at the door. I couldn't not open the door now. So I was worried what he might do, whether he's going to come in with alcohol. So I opened the door and he said simply that this is a book that belongs to your lot. And he gave it to me. That's it, and he left. So I opened the book, and it was about religion and Islam, and I started reading it and reading it. And he said, I became mesmerized by this. I couldn't believe the wisdom inside this book, the morality that was being spoken about. I couldn't believe the way in which God was being described. It had not been presented to me in such a fashion before. He said, I didn't know whether this man was fell into that sect or this sect. He said, but what I told myself is, whatever, whoever this man is, and whichever sect he falls into, that's the sect I want to become. That's the Muslim I want to become. I want to become like this man. He said, that book, today I know it as Nahjul Balagha. He said, that book, when I researched and I realized this was written by Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said, after that, I became of this sect, of the Shi'i sect. But you look at the difficulty he had to go through. A man who was consumed by sin, a man who was indulging in all pleasures, had to open his eyes. And when he opened his eyes, he had to take that uphill task of leaving that previous life behind him, leaving his friend circles around him. But you look at how God guided him. A book that was printed in the Middle East ended up past the oceans into the hand of an alcoholic who brought it to his house, and God guided him. But we didn't have to go through any of that. It was given to us on a plate, which indicates to you and I that our responsibility towards this religion, our responsibility towards God and the Ahlul Bayt alayhim wassalam, is much greater than the responsibility shouldered by many other people. As we gather here to celebrate the birth of the seventh holy Imam, Imam Al-Kadhim alayhi salam, we note that sometimes when we speak about the Imams, one particular characteristic stands out from amongst them. If we came to celebrate and remember the fourth holy Imam, the first thing that comes to our mind about him is that he was a man who worshipped a great deal. His name denotes that, Zainul Abidin, the title that he has given. When we speak about the third holy Imam in Sha'ban, we'll probably speak about his sacrifice that this man had. Imam Ali alayhi salam will speak about justice, sixth Imam, about knowledge. When it comes to the seventh holy Imam, we normally speak about him being patient, a man who had a lot of patience, and I'll mention why, but that's very clear. What I want to just remind ourselves is that these men, this lady, the prophets that we have, they were holistic people. They couldn't have been role models to you and I if they only perfected one aspect of their life. If they were only men and women who worship God in a mosque, then they couldn't be role models for you and I, because they don't face the difficulty that you and I did. If this prophet of ours never got married and never had a wife and didn't know the temptations, then you couldn't take him as a holistic role model. When the prophet is sent as the most perfect man, he had to have eaten what you and I ate. He had to have dressed like you and I dressed, meaning in accordance with what the community dresses like and the people dress like. He has to have worked. He had to have worked. It's not possible that you take a role model who doesn't understand the pressures of when it comes to earning a halal rizq. If he never had to work and he just took from Baytul Mal, then it's your argument and my argument against God that you gave us a role model who never worked with his own two hands. He didn't know what it meant to earn a halal rizq, and you've put that burden on me. But yet you find these Imams one after the other, that they are husbands, they are fathers, they eat what we eat, they dress like we dress, they marry a spouse, they have children. All of the tests that come in life came to them, and sometimes, or definitely, even more. Yet what stands out amongst from them is that they remain steadfast. They didn't flinch, and that's why we celebrate them. We celebrate them because these were men and women who were steadfast, and that's why you and I can take them as role models. When it comes to Al-Kadhim alayhi salam, the Imam alayhi salam, the title Al-Kadhim means somebody who restrains, and we know that. We know that this Imam was put in prison three different times. First taken from Medina to Baghdad. Then Harun al-Rashid places him in prison another two times after that. In one of the ziyarat of the seventh holy Imam, it's mentioned, one of the sentences that we say is salam upon the one who was tortured in the depths of the prison. A man who not only was imprisoned, but then tortured immensely in prison as well. Yet you find that there are other aspects of his life that we can benefit from as well. In Medina, Mufid mentions that in Medina, this was a man who was known as Al-Mutahajjid, the man who would be devout in prayer, especially in the night, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he was put in prison for the second time by Harun, you realize that he even worshipped God immensely in prison as well. When you think about what somebody would do in prison, you'd probably think that they need to keep themselves challenged mentally. They'll try to memorize things. They'll try to speak to people and engage with other people. They'll do certain types of exercises to keep themselves healthy and mentally and physically. That must have been there. But one thing that stood out is the worship of the Imam. One of the jail keepers, known as Isa, he writes a letter to Harun and he says, you either come and take this man from me or I'm going to free him. And then he says, why? He says, you've kept him with me for an entire year. He says, I sent spies in the prison. There were people around him who he thought were prisoners, but he didn't know they were my spies. They were listening to everything he said. We were waiting for him to slip just once, just to curse you or me one time, and that would have been enough to sign his death warrant. He says, but for a whole year, I've sent spies after spies. He says, every time he opened his mouth, he was either asking God for forgiveness or mercy. That's it. He said, he's never spoken against you, or he's never spoken against me. So I have no reason now to kill this man. I can't do it. And then he mentioned something which is much stranger, which is hopefully the topic I'd like to discuss. He says, this man is so thankful that I've never met somebody as thankful as him despite him being in prison. He says, I have heard, my spies have heard, that when he goes to prostration, he says frequently, not just once, but frequently he says, oh Allah, I used to ask you to give me a time when you remove from me my responsibilities so that I can worship you, and you've done just that for me. The perspective that he had of being in prison was not to turn around to God and complain. Rather, it was to thank God for having answered his prayer. Not in the way he prayed for it. No imam prayed, oh God, send me to prison so you remove responsibilities. These were men of courage and bravery who wanted to action their responsibility of what they had of guiding people. But when they were placed in prison, even that, does Imam Hussein alayhi salam not say, he says, Ridham biqada'ihi wa tasliman li amri. Not only does Imam say that I'm going to submit to your command, well, you have no choice. If God places you in prison, it's not like you have a choice. But the Imam goes a step further and he says, I'm going to be pleased. I'm going to be pleased with your decree. If you've placed him in prison, and not in prison because he's done something wrong. He was placed in prison because of jealousy, because fear of Harun, that he felt the Imam will uprise with the Shia. This was an Imam who had to live in Taqiyah. This was an Imam who couldn't go out and propagate like his father. Just a generation previously, his father had an entire university at his feet. His father had thousands of students coming to learn from him. The majority of our traditions come from the sixth holy Imam, yet you find a generation later, his son is placed in prison. His son cannot proclaim and speak openly. Even his followers had to follow him in secrecy. A mention is given in Mufid's book about Ali ibn Yaqtin. Ali was in the palace of Harun. He was a close companion of Harun, a close help of Harun. But people doubted that he was a Shia. People doubted that he was a follower of the seventh holy Imam. So they kept telling Harun that this man, he's actually against you. He doesn't actually believe in you. He doesn't accept you as the caliph of the time. And Harun would test him numerous times every time Ali would be successful. There was one final test that he gives. It shows you, one, Ali's allegiance to the seventh holy Imam. But it also shows you and I how the Imam was looking after his followers. He writes to the Imam, Ali, and he says that there is much doubt and conversation about how to do wudu. Our own people, as in the Shia, are saying that you might have to do it when you come to the mas' of the feet. You have to take your hand, put it at your ankle and wipe down towards your toes. But we've heard differently. We've been practicing differently. He says, please write to me in your own handwriting. I don't want someone else to write it. I know your writing. I'll recognize it. Write to me in your own handwriting and tell me how to do wudu. So Imam writes to him and he says, oh Ali, act upon this letter and do not transgress even a slight bit. And he begins to mention how to do wudu. When he comes to the mas' of the feet, he says, then take your hand and put it at the ankle and wipe it down towards the toes. So Ali becomes extremely confused. He knows. He knows he's been taught in this fashion. He's read it. He's attended classes of this. He's seen the Shia doing this, yet his imam is saying something completely contrary. And then the imam specifies that I don't want you to transgress. So Ali does exactly that. First thing to note is that his allegiance to the Imam was such that even if Imam told him to do something that he was certain about, Imam said do the contrary, he still did it. When the 12th Imam reappears soon, inshallah, and if the command is given that I want you, just you to pray that way, when the entire community prays that way, there's probably going to be a lot of doubt cast on this man. That why is he telling me to pray in the opposite direction? He doesn't know what he's saying. He can't be the imam of the time. So Ali begins to do wudu in this fashion. And then one of the companions of Harun comes and says, oh Harun, go and test Ali on his wudu. Because the difference between us and them is that we wipe our feet from the toes up, we wipe it from the ankle down, and they wipe it from the toes up. So Harun goes behind the wall of Ali's house. He waits for salah time. Ali comes out, goes to the pond in the front, begins to do wudu, wipes from the ankle down, and Harun jumps out. He says, Ali, I'll never doubt you again. And he gives Ali a great position. As soon as Harun leaves, a letter comes from a messenger, and the Imam now writes to Ali and says, oh Ali, from now you do wudu in the manner that the Shia do wudu. And he mentions this method that you and I do it till today. It shows that the Imam, despite being sometimes in prison, sometimes being held under captivity, house arrest, whatever it may have been, he was still looking out for his followers. But then he comes to this point of being thankful, that the Imam never complained to God. He was thankful even in the most difficult and dire states. I want to look at the Quran and see whether or not these men, were they adhering to the Quran? Does the Quran tell us to be thankful to this extent? That in everything we do, as the Quran commanded us, oh people, thank God. Or has the Quran told us, no, you can also complain to God about your difficulties. Be lazy, don't work hard, just complain to God. Or has the Quran said, work hard, and even if difficulties come upon you, thank Allah for everything that comes upon you. Count your blessings. Has he said this in the Quran? Or are we just taking from guides because their stories that are mentioned in history sound very good to us? We begin with the verse of Quran that tells us to listen to the Quran. Allah says, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. When the Quran is recited, listen to it. Interesting. Sometimes you might have Quran playing in your houses on a speaker. You might think it's good that the environment, there's Quran being played. It might be barakah for the environment, but we can still talk to each other. Allah is saying quite the opposite in the Quran. He's saying, as soon as the Quran is being recited, I'm commanding you to be quiet, to listen. There is no exception where you should be speaking above the Quran with regards to worldly affairs. وَأَنْسِطُ. أَنْسِطُ doesn't mean be silent. It means when somebody is speaking to you, you don't utter a jawab, don't go and reply to it. You're very attentive to what's being said. Allah is saying, be attentive to what's being recited. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Maybe God will have mercy on you. Which means what? That if you don't listen to the Quran when it's being recited, it's unlikely that God will have mercy upon you. So this Quran that is our guide, that Allah says that I've placed every parable within it, that Allah says it guides to that which is most upright. What does it say about thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When it comes to having children, and when we talk about being thankful to our parents, there is not one child who will say that one shouldn't be thankful to their parents. You don't know what they've done for you and I, so Allah recounts numerous times in the Quran and talks about parents. At one particular point, he says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا. That we've commanded man to have good relations, to be good to his parents. Why? Because his mother, حَمَلَتْهُ, has carried him, وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْن, with difficulty and weakness upon weakness. And for 2 years, she nurtures him and nourishes him and gives him milk. After saying all the qualities of this mother and what she's done, you expect Allah now to turn and conclude the sentence by saying, and be thankful towards your parents. But he says, instead, he says, and thank me and be thankful towards your parents. The first command is back towards God. That even though this mother has done what she has done for you, even though all this grace and bounties have come towards you, the first person you need to thank, the first entity you must thank is not your mother. Because she was only able to carry you in her womb because I allowed it. She only gave birth to you and you didn't die while she was giving birth to you because I allowed it. How many a child are born and get suffocated by the umbilical cord as they're being born? How many a child are born and they can't see and they can't smell and they can't hear? Yet you've come from this womb of your mother. And she nourished you? No, I nourished you. I simply used as my conduit to nourish you. I used as my tool to nourish you. So when you thank, yes, you must thank the creation. But prior to thanking the creation, you must thank the creator. Many a times, even on the day of judgment, the opposite is mentioned. Allah is continuously telling us when it comes to thanks, it's creation and creator together. Don't just take one over the other. On the day of judgment, man stands in front of God and there's a tradition in which he says that, oh God, I thanked you. In this life, I thanked you. But Allah says, but oh man, you didn't thank the people the people you lived with, the community that you shared with, that you broke bread with, the neighbors that I gave you, the parents I gave you, the siblings, the friends. This was not a religion that was meant to be acted upon in solitude, an individual religion that you just cared about yourself. You had to take care of your community as well. At times Allah says, thank people. But at other times in the Quran, He reminds us that I want you to thank me. Because if you thank me for what you have, you will realize who you truly are. That you're a human being that I've created, who is completely weak, who can't do anything. And everything I've given you, you must thank me for. When He tells Musa, oh Musa, I want you to ask me for the salt that you give and you place in your dough. Ask me for the lace that you tie your sandal with. Why? Why does Musa have to be thankful for this? Why does he have to remind himself that he wants this from God? Because Allah says in the Quran, Antumul fuqara'u ila Allah. You're completely poor in the eyes of Allah. You don't own anything. Everything that you and I have is because of Allah. So then He says in the Quran, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. That if you thank, I will increase you. That all I want you to do is to realize the blessings that you have. How easy it is that man falls into this trap of complaining and complacency. It's very easy for man to say and complain that my child doesn't listen to me and my child has gone astray and my child is... Has he ever sat and thanked and raised his hands and told Allah that thank you for giving me children? How many a parent there are who strive to have a child but God hasn't gifted them with the blessing of children? And how many parents there are who don't intend to have a child yet Allah blesses them with children? When somebody complains about the work that they have and the long hours that they have to put in, and the little wealth that they have, do they start that conversation with God first by saying, thank you for giving me a job. Thank you that I'm able to provide for my family. When they complain about the shelter that they have they begun by saying, Allah, at least you've given me shelter. Did we not take advantage of this Quran when it talked to us about Ayyub and the difficulties that he had? And finally, what's his dua? Oh Allah, difficulty has touched me, and he complains that his children died, that all his cattle died, that all his wheat was burnt overnight. None of the like, that he was ill. He turns to God and he says, "Anni masani al-dhur." Allah, difficulty has touched me, wa anta arhamur rahimin. But you're the most merciful of the merciful ones. I'm not going to tell you how to deal with me. I'll tell you what I want. I'll tell you what I think is good for me. I'll beg you for it and I'll ask you for it. But at the end of the day, whatever you give me, I know is going to be best for me. Not once did the seventh Imam turn around and say, why did you put me in prison? Me, a man who has never sinned, a man who has never gone against you, why do you put me in prison and allow people to torture me? Not once. Instead, you just see that thanks after thanks is coming from this man's mouth. Allah throughout the Quran is reminding us that be thankful even for the past. Don't just look at the present. When it comes to the people of Musa alayhi salam, Allah tells Musa, oh Musa, remind your people, Bani Israel, the sons of Ya'qub, remind them of the days of Allah. And then the verse continues, and Musa says, oh people, do you remember when Allah removed you from the difficulty of Fir'aun? Have you forgotten it, that now you want to go away from him? Have you remembered that when you went to the Red Sea, it split open? Have you remembered how he used to slaughter your boys and let your girls live? Have you remembered that? Have you thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it? It's very easy to complain, but it's difficult to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially at times of difficulty. But the difference you find between a believer and an individual who has lip service to God, is that even when a believer is in difficulty, he'll thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Prophet was pushed out of Mecca and went to the Shi'ab of Abu Talib, do you remember the pact that was there? The pact between the people of Mecca, the polytheists? They said that we will not sell to Muhammad and anyone who follows him. We will not allow our girls, our daughters to be married into Muhammad. When he comes to the market, we agree between ourselves that we will increase the prices of our commodities such that they cannot afford it. One of the reasons for Sayyidah Khadija's death was because this lady didn't have enough to eat when she was in the Shi'ab of Abu Talib. This lady who sacrificed for her husband, for the Prophet of Allah, yet you find that she would split a date. But not once do you find the Prophet complaining. Not once do you find Sayyidah Khadija complaining. Why? Because they knew that so long as I am under the protection of God, if this is the test He wants me to be in, then I'm going to be in it. But allow me to conclude by reminding ourselves that we must not misunderstand thanking God for complacency and laziness. You do not find one imam or one prophet who was complacent, who was lazy. When they went to work, they didn't just come back and say, okay, whatever was given to me, I'm going to be thankful for it. I'm not going to work harder. You find that these men worked hard. If you're not happy with the job that you're in, it doesn't mean that you turn to God and say, okay, God, I thank you and I'm going to be content with what I have. It means that you work hard. If doors don't open, then you thank God. And if doors open, you thank God. But the one thing that you and I should remember is that sometimes God doesn't open doors to what we ask for because it's not good for us. That you end your dua by saying, Allah, I think this is good for me and that is good for me and I ask you for this and I ask you for that. But if it's good for me, then give it to me. And if it's not good for me, keep it away from me and give me the wisdom to understand why you've held it back from me. Why would you want something which is not good for you? A man goes to the haram of the 8th Holy Imam, Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam. He goes to the Holy Imam's shrine, and within the shrine, as you enter one of the doors, there's a mystic who's buried there. He enters, he goes first to the haram, he asks numerous times at the haram, asks Allah for a particular hajj that he wants. He doesn't get what he's asking for. Numerous times, doesn't get it. Day in, day out, doesn't get it. Finally, he thinks, maybe the imam doesn't love me, he's not interceding on my behalf. I'm going to go through this scholar instead. So he comes through the door of the haram, stands by the grave of this scholar, and he says that the ulama can do shafa'ah. So I ask Allah, because of the love that he has for this man, that he should give me my haja. And the next day he gets it. He becomes depressed. Falls into a state of despair that the imam didn't do shafa'ah for me, the imam didn't intercede for me, and here another scholar was able to do shafa'ah and I got what I wanted the next day. A month later he realizes that what he was asking for wasn't good for him. So he comes back to the grave of this scholar, he stands by it, and he says, oh man, if you don't know when to give, then don't give. And many a times our life pans out like this. Sometimes we don't understand the wisdom as to why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't give us something that we plead and we ask for. But at the end of the day, if you and I are conscious about God and we realize that He's looking after you and He, then obviously what He's giving to you and I can only be good. In conclusion, throughout the Quran, there are numerous verses that talk about thanking Allah. Every other prophet, Allah talks about how he thanked Allah. Nuh alayhi salam, the verse I began with. Allah, when he's talking to Musa, he says, O people, O children of Israel, remember that you've come from Nuh, and this was a man who I carried on a ship. Why? Because he was Abdan Shakura. I gave him and I protected him from a flood only because he was a thankful servant. You and I have a duty to work hard in this life. Allah's mentioned it in the Quran that I've kept a portion of the dunya for you as well. This dunya is there for you and I. Go out, work hard, acquire it. Live a good life. Don't fall into haram. Don't become extravagant, but live a good life. Work hard. But at the same time, don't forget the blessings that I've given you. Be thankful for what I've given you, because if you're not thankful for it, then I'll take it away. And when I take it away, there's no certainty that it's going to come back to you. The Imams alayhim wassalam, including Imam Al-Kadhim alayhi salam, remind us that sometimes the situation we are in may not be pleasant to us. But if it's pleasant to God, then our displeasure and discomfort should come second. When Yusuf alayhi salam was given that option, fall into what the women are calling you towards or go to prison, he says that I prefer and I'd love to go to prison more than what these women are calling me towards. The base desire was there with the women. But he says, oh God, I will prefer my displeasure. I will prefer my displeasure of going to prison over your displeasure. To be able to prioritize God in every situation requires somebody who truly appreciates the religion and the role models that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. In this holy month of Rajab, as it's begun, it's a month of dua, a month of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us try and take as much advantage as we can of it. If we're not habituated to thanking Allah, then maybe once every night, at least before we sleep, we sit on a sajada. It doesn't take more than 2 minutes, 5 minutes, just to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's but natural that when you begin to thank Him for one blessing, you'll remember another. You look at Imam al-Hussein's dua on the day of Arafah, this man who goes in the blazing heat of Arafah, and he comes out under the sun, and he begins to speak from his heart, and he thanks Allah for the things that probably have passed our minds before. He thanks Allah for his molar teeth. He thanks Allah for the creases on his forehead. He thanks Allah for his eyebrows and his eyelashes, for his large intestines and his small intestines. These are things we probably haven't thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. There are things that are tangible in front of us. Our children, our spouse, our garments. These are things that we have to thank Allah for. And if there's a time where you think that God's not treating you right, if there's a time that you think that God's not listening to your prayer, don't look up to the people who have more than you. Rather look down and look at the people who have less than you. Do you remember when the refugee crisis took place in Calais, when you had so many refugees coming to Calais? A group of brothers had gone, and there was one particular incident that stood out for them, that they went and there were a load of jackets that they had taken. You know, when you try and raise funds and people start giving you different types of clothes, so they had had bags and bags of different types of jackets, and they stood in line, and there was a whole line of people who had come, fathers and sons. You know how embarrassing it is for a parent to have to stand with their child in a line to be given at no cost, a handout. It's embarrassing for any mother or father or any parent that the child should see them stretching their hands. But they did it because of the plight that they were in. But what was strange is that when those fathers and those children, when they came to the front of the line, the people who were distributing jackets weren't there to ask them, what brand would you like? What color would you like? What size are you? They simply looked at this individual and made a guess and took out a jacket or whatever size it may have been and gave it to them. But the delight on those people's faces, the delight that I've been given something that will shield me from the winter, was something that shows you and I what true thankfulness is. True thankfulness is not that Allah answers our dua in the way I want it to be answered. I might want a particular type of house. I might want to live a particular type of life. I might want a certain amount of wealth. That's not Allah listening to my dua. Allah listening to my dua is when He gives me enough and that which will not take me astray. And that's why the Holy Prophet says, oh Allah, give Muhammad and Al Muhammad that which is sufficient and suffices them. Don't give me more because I'm going to be answerable for it. It'll be difficult for me to live with this amount of wealth. It'll take me over. I'll become that person I thought I never would become. It's easy for the peasant to point fingers at the wealthy and say, how is it that he spends money in this fashion? That he's so extravagant? Had I had this wealth, I would have used it to do this and do that. It's only when you and I are placed in that position that the test actually begins. The Prophet says, don't give us more because it can take us astray. It can blind us. And don't give us less, because life will become extremely difficult to live in this fashion. Give us that which suffices us. It's a reminder to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what He's given us, to continuously work hard for that which we want, and to complete and end our dua by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if what I've asked for is not good for me, then don't give it to me, but give me the wisdom to understand why you've held it back from me. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين
Ahsant, Sheikh, for those words of wisdom and lessons from the life of the Imam, especially the seventh Imam, Ahsant. Announcements. Today, Sunday, 29th January 2023, eve of 7th Rajab, 1444. Wednesday, 1st February is strike day. No, sorry, it's Wiladat of Imam Muhammad Taqi alayhi salam. Program will start at 8 p.m. with Quran Majlis in English by Dr. Ehsan Rangiha. I think the strikes will have finished by then, so we'll be able to make it. Second, Ladies Yard team presents Jashne Maulud to celebrate the Khushalis of the Holy Household on Thursday, 16th March. This will be in parallel with the Gents Thursday program. YDD are now enrolling boys and girls aged 5 to 14 years for recitation of three short du'as and du'a iftitah in the month of Ramadan. To register for auditions, please email ydd@hujjat.org. Burial Fund team have sent emails where available with renewals for 2023. Please check your inbox as well as your junk and spam folders. Those that have asked for postal renewals, these have been posted out. If you haven't received the renewal, please get in touch with the Burial Fund team by emailing bf@hujjat.org or contact the team. The Hujjat membership subscriptions for the year 2023 is now due. You can pay either online or at the treasurer's desk. Please ensure that your subscriptions are up to date to ensure full access to all Hujjat services, including the previously mentioned burial fund, from January 2023 until December 2023. Utility prices are extremely high. Please help us by donating towards our general fund. There was a brother who suggested that you also try Money Supermarket or Compare the Market. I'm sure they have done that, Ahsant. Calendars for 2023 can be purchased for £1 at treasurer's desk. And finally, those wishing to recite in the Gents main hall during Mahe Mubarak Ramadan programs are advised to email their requests to recite@hujjat.org, and please include your mobile contact number. Ahsant. We will now have Qasida followed by Munajat, and we'll conclude with Ziyarat. So may I please ask you to welcome Brother Murtaza Akbar Ali with a salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Kul imam haq da imam nar haydari haydar mola ali mola haydar mola mere mola haydar mola ali mola haydar mola mere mola ha کہتا ہوں علی مجھ کو خدا لگتا ہے پھر بھی دنیا کو میرا عشق برا لگتا ہے میں نے بس اتنا کہا بعد خدا بعد نبی से जुदा लगता है। हमरा नाज है ये, मेरा हमराज है ये, इसकी खिलकत पे खुदा कहने लगा मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है। मरियम को बैतुल मुकद्दस से बाहर भेजा था जब किबरिया ने, ये घर विलादत का मरकज नहीं है, जाओ ये बोला खुदा ने। आई जब तेरा रजब खुद ही कहने लगा रब, आइए बिन्त असद सल्ले अला, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग हैदर की बात अलग हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे की बात अलग है। पहुँचे जो मेराज पर मुस्तफ़ा तो पर्दे से आवाज़ आई, ए मेरे महबूब मेरी मोहब्बत तुमको यहाँ खींच लाई। जब वो आवाज़ सुनी आ गए याद अली, थी मोहम्मद के लबों पर ये सदा, मेरे हैदर यार हैदर की बात अलग है, की बात अलग है, हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है। ये ज़ुल्फ़िकार अली जानती है चलना है किस पर कहाँ से, मरहब का सर काटने के लिए जब हैदर ने खींचा मियां से, चमकर दस्त जली बुलुठी तेग अली, आ जाएगा कटाई का मजा, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है। मन कुन तो मौला का ऐलान सुनकर चिल्ला के हारिस ये बोला, मुझ पर अज़ाब खुदा पड़ेगा, है ये अली सबका मौला। सर पे कंकर जो लगा आई हारिस को कजा, जितने मुनकिर थे उन्हें कहना पड़ा, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है। गाजी की चौकट पे बैठे हुए थे, होंठों पे बस ये दुआ थी, ए मौला बस हम पर करम हो, मिदहत करे मुर्तजा की। अभी जारी थी दुआ हो गई हम पे अता, मिलके कहने लगे जी शान और रजा, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है, हैदर की बात अलग है, मेरे हैदर की बात अलग है। हैदर मौला अली मौला, हैदर मौला मेरे मौला, हैदर मौला अली मौला, हैदर मौला मेरे मौला। नारे हैदरी मोहम्मद वाले मोहम्मद सलवात।
یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ آیا ہوں در پہ آپ کے اور کرتا ہوں سوال، تم ہی میرے حاجت روا ہو فاطمہ کے لا، سامان غیب کر دو میرے واسطے فی الحال، ٹل جائے جس سے سارا میرا رنج اور ملال۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ بیمار ہے جو بھی شفا ان کو عطا کر، بے جرم اسیروں کو میرے مولا رہا کر، ظلمت کے اندھیروں میں میرے مولا ضیا کر، مومن کی مقدر میں ولا اور عزا کر۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ خالق نے تمہیں خلق کا مختار بنایا، بٹکے ہوئوں کو آپ نے ہی راستہ دکھایا، میں بھی ہوں پریشان کرو لطف کا سایہ، اور کر دے عطا آپ سے جو مانگنے آیا۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، تیرے حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ کیا آج نہ امید مجھے پھیریں گے گھر سے، ایسا کبھی ہوا ہی نہیں آپ کے گھر سے، خالی پھرا نہیں کوئی آپ کے در سے، میں ہو کے غلام آپ کا خالی پھروں کیسے۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن حسین مصیبت سے بچاؤ۔ یا موسیٰ کاظم ہمیں آفت سے چراؤ، بحر حسن हसन हुसैन मुसीबत से बचाओ मोहसिन पे अता लफ्ज़ की खैरात हो मौला बस लब पे तेरा जिक्र ही दिन रात हो मौला मोमिन पे सदा रहमत की बरसात हो मौला दिन हशर के बस आपका ही साथ हो मौला या मूसा काज़िम हमें आफत से चुराओ बेरे हसन हुसैन मुसीबत से बचाओ या मूसा काज़िम हमें आफत से चुराओ बेरे हसन हुसैन मुसीबत से बचाओ फातिमा
Let us pray we may all be granted the opportunity to visit our Imam in Ghazmain. Ziyarat-e Maqsoos. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Assalamu alayka ya Wali Allah. Assalamu alayka ya Hujjat Allah. السلام عليك يا نور الله في ظلمات الأرض السلام عليك يا من يد الله في شانه أتيتك زائرا عارفا بحقك مواديا لأدائك مواليا لأوليائك فاشفع لي عند ربك يا مولاي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا رسول الله السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين السلام عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين السلام عليك يا حسن المجتبى السلام عليك يا حسين الشهيد بكربلاء السلام عليك يا علي بن الحسين زين العابدين السلام عليك يا محمد ابن علي الباقر المنبيين السلام عليك يا جعفر ابن محمد الصادق السلام عليك يا موسى ابن جعفر الكاظم السلام عليك يا علي ابن موسى أيها الرضا السلام عليك يا محمد ابن علي التقي الجواد السلام عليك يا علي ابن محمد الهادي النقي السلام عليك يا حسن ابن علي الزكي العسكري السلام عليك يا حجة الله يا ابن الحسن يا صاحب اليس والزمان السلام عليك يا كعبة الإيمان السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن عجل الله فرجه وسهل الله تعالى مخرجه وظهورك ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائداً وناصراً ودليلاً وعيناً حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعاً وتمتعه فيها طويلاً برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين
Brothers, please sit down so tabarruk can be served in a safe manner. Please sit down so tabarruk can be served. Inshallah, and kushali mubarak to you all from the volunteers. Brothers, your attention, please. I found a phone around the front here. So if it is yours, please collect it from the treasurer's desk. Asad.
Thank you. Thank you.